Good morning, Glenmore Church. Peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I gave the praise band off today, so enough with the all the preludes and so forth. Let's stand and greet one another in the name of this resurrected Jesus. Good morning and welcome to worship. Make sure this is on. Check, one, two. Spirit of the living God ready? Okay. Let's remain standing and invoke the Holy Spirit. Let's sing. Sing with me.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Amen. You may be seated. Jesus Christ has risen. And indeed, he has risen. Thank you very much. You're awake this morning. You're awake. You're going to be awake after I preach this morning. So I welcome you to this hour of worship. We have spent 40 days putting the world behind us. Our theme, friends, is the world behind us. The cross before us. If you're a visitor here today, I welcome you unto the resurrected Jesus, his name. I pray that you're here for a reason. I don't know what that reason is, but I'm glad you're here in worship today, and I want to welcome you. Just a few announcements before we enter into the heart of worship. Reminder that we still have three active adult Bible studies going on here at this church. Our Men of the Sabbath, which I lead on Saturday mornings from 8:30 to 10, continues to meet. We just had a little mini study of the book of Jude, and we're moving on to another very small book, the book of Joel, that we'll spend a couple weeks on. But we spent about 7 months in the book of Romans, the rich book of Romans. So we're kind of meandering here and there. We're going to land on a large epistle here before long. But we continue to meet here. Men are invited here, 8:30 to 10. We have great fellowship. Saturday we had probably 25 guys here, both on Zoom and in the room. So it was wonderful. Our women's community Bible study meets Tuesday afternoons here, 1 to 2:30. They are studying Charles Stanley's 30 life principles. My wife Donna leads that group along with Deb Boyd. All women invited. Tuesday, I don't know, honey, what do we get? 20, 25 women here. It's a wonderful fellowship and a great learning experience. And our own Mike Cornaco is leading this Adam Hamilton study, Luke, Jesus, and the Outsiders, Outcasts, and Outlaws. This is a Wednesday evening study starting at 7:15, going to about 8:30 or so. So you're sitting in a church right now where we study the Word of God, and that was one of the challenges that we had starting on Ash Wednesday, and then this 40-day journey towards the cross is that we pray more this 40 days. We study the Word of God more. We enter into daily devotion more. We spend more time at home in prayer and in study. And it's really, really helping. Wanted to remind you, put this date on your calendar. April 23rd is our women's lunch, our Methodist women's luncheon, right after worship. Remind you, next week is Scout Sunday. Beautiful combination of worship. And our Boy Scouts and our Cub Scouts from our Troop 79 will be here to honor us. Want to remind you of our VBS, our community VBS, starting June 19th through the 23rd. Still looking for volunteers as we continue to sign up children for that event in June. And our car show, our first annual Glenmore car show, May 13th, right out here on our campus, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. All cars that are from 1990 on up are invited, antique cars, custom cars. It's a family day. It's going to be a beautiful day. We'll have a DJ here and just a great experience exposing our campus. So those are the announcements today. As we continue to meander in, I'll ask Paul to lead us in the call to worship. Would you rise, please? Turn your eyes to the heavens. Turn your gaze to hope and life. For in hope and life, we find Jesus, the risen Christ, who shines in our midst with the light of heaven.
Christ is alive,
moving among the living.
Christ is risen,
inviting us to rise in fullness of life.
Christ is calling,
proclaiming life and hope for all. Let's remain standing, turned in our hymnals to number 322. Up from the grave, he arose. Let's sing.
Jesus, my Savior,
in the coming day.
Jesus, my Lord,
you join me in this intercessory prayer found in your bulletin. Pray with me. Risen Christ, enter our worship and our hearts today. As you live and move among us in our hearts today, remind us to proclaim and live out the life you offer each of us. Inspire us to walk as children of your resurrection. Each and every day, help us to search our hearts and our souls for this spiritual solace of your resurrection, not just today, but every day, that we claim the life you offer us, to embrace your love and live in your risen presence. In hope and in joy, we pray. Amen. Amen. I'll ask our ushers to come forward, move amongst us for his tithes and our offerings, and I'll invite our chancel choir up for this beautiful offertory this morning. My song, cornerstone, solid ground. The drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace. Fears are still when striving cease. Comforter, all in all, His love I stand. Christ alone took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, the gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. On the cross at Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live.
Attached.
We thank you, God, for this day, for this Resurrection Sunday, God. We thank you for the blood, for the cross. We thank you for your sacrifice. God, this is all for you. And we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Morning, Paul.
Today's scripture reading can be found on page 944 of the Pew Bible from John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Please follow along. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter then came out with the other disciple, and they went toward the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying, and the napkin, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Saying this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned to him and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and said to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the living Lord, our God, Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Paul. Questions for this Easter 2023. Do you know Christ? Are you sure he's in your life and your heart? Perhaps you have been thinking lately, "I want to be sure. I want to be sure. I want to have peace with the Lord God. I want to be sure that I'm ready for death. I want my sins forgiven. I want my guilt removed. I want to be with Christ when he comes and sets up his kingdom." Well, today, it's all yours. It's free. No need to work for it, for by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is a gift of God and not of works, friends. That is your living proof. Welcome to Easter Sunday. Let's pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. I've always felt that Easter was the easiest Sunday for preaching for some reason. There is always a great sense of celebration in the congregation on Easter, usually the largest attendance of the year, great meaningful music to support the worship hour, a feeling of victory over defeat, and I like winning. I like winning. I also realize that there are some folks here today that have not realized that the stone has been rolled away, that Jesus was somehow held back, that they have not seen the proof they need in their lives, that the Word of God has never been clear to them, or they have never taken the time to delve into it. So in other words, for me, there is still much work to do as a pastor in getting this message out that we have a living proof of a victory in Jesus Christ, each of us. In 1983, ABC ran the movie The Day After. Do you remember that movie? More than 100 million people, nearly 39 million households, watched this film during its initial broadcast. 100 million people. Now, I don't know if you are familiar with television ratings and such, but this TV movie, friends, The Day After, grabbed a 46 rating, a 62% share of the viewing audience during that initial broadcast that night. 62%. It was the seventh highest rated non-sports show back then. It was a record as the highest rated television film in history until 2009. There were warnings by the producers of graphic scenes, and ABC actually set up an 800 hotline with counselors standing by to tell callers what? What? If you and I could imagine such a possible nuclear winter experience would cause millions to think of their future, how much more so should the fact that however the end may come for them, the real day after for those who reject Christ, the living God, is not this grim oblivion, but even worse judgment, which would take this TV portrayal and make it seem like a walk in the park. Do I have your attention yet? Okay, now, are you ready for some good news? Have you dialed into the 800 number of Seeking Answers? Do I have your full attention online as we speak to one another this morning? You see, friends, your future and my future does not hinge on the world situation, however confusing and frustrating and challenging and alone we may feel at times with all of this. Your life and my life depends on what happened 2,000 years ago at the cross. And your acceptance or your rejection of what happened there to the Prince of Peace. You're here today, friend, for a reason, aren't you? So today, ask yourself right now, why am I here? Why am I here today? What is my reason? You say to me, Danny, my quest for Jesus Christ ends today. Terrific. I'm saved, Danny. I know where I'm going when I die. Outstanding. You say, I want to ask him now, this risen Savior, into my heart and my soul. I want to finally put to rest my shame that I have carried around for years. I want to lay my fears to rest. I want to ask Jesus to forgive my doubt today. I want Christ in my life and accept him now as Savior and Lord. Terrific. One of my favorite Psalms 118 is a praise hymn where the writer speaks of the attributes of the Lord. The psalm reminds us of His almighty and His loving power, the power of love, and has a faithful love that lasts forever. That's God's love. The theme is of a confidence in God's eternal love. Do you know what that means? Also in the book of Jude, chapter 1, verses 20 and 21, Jude, the brother of Jesus, writes this. He says, "But you, dear friends, must build each other up in your most holy faith. Pray in the power of the Holy Spirit and await the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will bring you eternal life. In this way, you will keep yourselves safe in God's love." Friends, God's love is unchanging in the midst of an ever-changing situation or circumstance in your life. It does not change. It is unchanging. This should give you and I complete security and a living proof, if you choose to believe it, of His resurrection power. So in our text this morning, we have John's account of the resurrection. He takes us to the first day of the week and reminds us that it was still dark. Verse 1, those words, "still dark," may be your life right now, still dark. I know that some of you today are living in a dark place outside of the tomb. Well, Mary Magdalene came to that darkness as well. She walked towards this dark only to discover what? That the stone was rolled away. Hey, Jesus could have walked through the stone tomb, the big rock in front of it, and appeared to people that next day. The stone was not rolled away in order for God to get out. It was rolled away so others, you and me, could get in and see that Jesus was gone. But this living proof does not come easy for some of us, does it? It just doesn't. Mary and the disciples of Jesus were just like us. Some may have thought, "Ha, this is merely a fabrication and it's impossible to believe." That may very well be you today. Peter himself ran to the tomb when Mary came back and told his friends, "He was gone. He was gone." Peter was really a smart guy. He walked into the tomb and wanted to see for himself. Verse 6, and Eugene Peterson's paraphrase says this, "Stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloth lying there, the kerchief that covered Jesus' head neatly folded, then went into the entire tomb to see for himself." The other disciples went in and took one look at the evidence and believed. They believed. No one yet knew from the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. No one. They saw and they believed. Now these men went home, but our text says Mary, well, she lingered. She lingered around. And why? Why? Verse 9 again, "For until then they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead." More proof. We need more proof. That is maybe why she lingered. Mary saw not only the empty tomb and the tossed aside grave clothes, but she then saw the living Jesus. She saw the living Jesus. Verse 12, she turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. Jesus asked, "Dear woman, why are you crying? Who are you looking for?" Then said this, "Mary." Jesus acknowledged her by name. He said, Mary, look at me. Look at me. Mary wanted to hug him because she didn't want to lose him again. What about you today, friend? Have you acknowledged the risen Christ, or still seeking more proof, or even doubting as the world does every day? Every day, the lie that Satan still promulgates in our minds and our hearts, or the world's propaganda machine that repeats that God is dead, over and over and over. In the Apostle Paul's day, a motto hung in the halls in Athens. It read this: once a man dies and the earth drinks up his blood, there is no resurrection. Paul hotly disagreed. American writer John Bartlett postulates, he says, well, when Athens died, so died the doubt of resurrection. No. As recently as the 19th century, there was a poem spreading around England that has caught all kinds of people off guard. The poem was written by Charles Swinburne. It says this: from too much love of living, from hope and fear set free, we thank with brief thanksgiving whatever gods may be, that no life lives forever, that dead men rise up never, that even the weariest river wine somewhere safe to see. Well, it's a lie. It's a lie, Bartlett writes. Dead men rise up ever, he writes, and there is no safety at sea apart from Christ. The resurrection, he writes, well, that's our only hope. Mary is our first witness, the world's first evangelist. She proclaims, I have seen the risen Lord. She could have also added, I have heard him speak my name. The world awaits in darkness to hear the latest news from the tomb. The world wants to know what we have seen and what we have heard from the living Christ. They're waiting to hear from you. This entire universe needs to hear these words. He is not here, for he has been raised from the dead. Because he lives, he, you, and me, we will also live. With all our flaws and all our sharp edges at times, we live also. Jesus said to his disciples in John 14 and 19, but soon, he said, the world will not see me, but you will see me. Since I live, he said, you shall also live. Friend, have you come to a living Easter faith in your life? You say, I'm not sure. Well, Mary wasn't sure either. Mary could have been really inspired by the angel she saw at the tomb. Hey, that may make a great movie in 2023. You know, focus on these really cool angels flying around this mythical tomb and looking kind of alien in their outfits. But Mary was not particularly inspired by the two angels that spoke to her. And she did not recognize even Jesus at first as he stood right next to her. Right next to her. But when Jesus called her name, Mary came to life and her faith came to life. Christ is calling your name and mine. She had living proof. Mary had living proof and ran to tell others of what she saw. No, we are here today, ladies and gentlemen, Easter Day, for a reason. My prayer today is that you have come in your heart and soul to an Easter faith and will carry it out this door this morning with you. as someone who, through the powerful testimony of Mary and Peter and the disciples, those first witnesses now have living proof and a living hope in their heart. I care deeply for your salvation in Christ. I do. Each one of you. If this is not how you came in this morning, but are ready to accept this living God, pray this prayer with me. Just close your eyes and pray this prayer. Oh God, I'm a sinner. You know it. I know it. I'm sorry for my sin. I'm willing today, right now, Lord, to turn from my sin. I receive Christ as Savior. I confess Him as Lord of my life. I want to follow Him the rest of my days to serve Him and others in the fellowship of His church and in His kingdom. This is my prayer. In Christ's name, amen. That is your salvation and eternal prayer today. Let me close with this. The great preacher Dwight L. Moody made a mistake on October 8th, 1971. He preached to his largest audience in the city of Chicago. The sermon title was, "What Will You Do Then with Jesus Who Is Called the Christ?" Now, we won't be able to fit that on our little sign out front, but that was his title. But Moody had said something he had never said before that night and, frankly, never said again. He was tired. And because of that, he said to his audience after he presented his sermon and the gospel lesson that night, he said, "Now I give you a week to think that over," he said. "And when we come together again, you will have an opportunity to respond." Well, Moody's traveling vocalist and gospel singer, Ira Sankey, began to sing at that very moment. Even before he finished the song, you could hear the blare of sirens in the streets of Chicago that night, now to be known as the Great Chicago Fire that broke out, left 100,000 people homeless. Hundreds of people died in that fire. And Dwight L. Moody rose to the occasion a few months later, and he said, "I would give my right arm before I would ever give an audience another week to think over the message of the gospel." However, some who heard his message died that night in that fire. Don't wait. You have all the proof you need today. Today, given you by the power of the sovereign word of God, we thank God for His Son, Jesus. He gave us eternal life, with His word, with His suffering, death, resurrection. For me, as a pastor, as a Christian man, this is the easiest Sunday in which to preach. Because of the living proof we have today, all praise to God for the resurrected Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. today and ask for any prayer concerns that you may have. But more importantly, I want to pray as a congregation, as corporate prayer. I want to pray for this nation. I want to pray for the evangelism of this great big nation of ours that always needs to improve, always needs to come to Christ. That's the answer. Think of every situation, every circumstance that we are fighting right now, every challenge. It's coming to Christ. It's coming to His Word. It's believing in His Word, living an obedient life. So that's my prayer today. I want to pray for sick people. I want to take some time right now in moments of silence as we pray for those who are sick, pray for those that are trying to heal, pray for those that are experiencing surgery coming up or medical tests, incredible debt, all kinds of things. I want us to pray right now in the silence of this room. Let's go to God. Father, we want to be Easter people. We want to walk with You, God. We want to talk with You. We want to love You more. We want to serve You more, God. This Easter, allow us to enter into a covenant with You, God, that we will turn from our doubt and our shame and our sin, Lord, that we will honor the cross, that we will look at that cross, Lord, maybe for the first time, Father, with its incredible meaning. The blood that's been spilled, Lord, You've taken that burden from us. Father, You know us by name. You call us by name. Our name is in the book of life. Father, we celebrate today. We celebrate Easter. We celebrate Your resurrection, God. This means everything, Father, that we can go forward and in challenge and in circumstance, come what may, God, we know that we have an eternal love, an eternal home, and a love that You allow us to have, Lord, that is everlasting. So thank You, God. Thank You for this church, Lord. We thank You for today, for 61 people coming out at sunrise, Lord, to worship with us today. An ecumenical service, God, of singing and preaching. We thank God for that. For our breakfast up at Faith Alliance Church, Lord, the fellowship there. We thank You, God, for the celebration of this Easter day. You have risen in our hearts, God, and we are indeed thankful. We're thankful for prayer. We're thankful for the disciples, Lord, who doubted once but came to know You in the Acts Church, Lord, and had no doubt after that, God. We thank You for prayer. You taught Your disciples to pray. You sat there and they said, we don't know how to pray and what to pray, and You taught this prayer. Pray with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. That's a great prayer, and we have a great closing hymn. So would you rise? Let's sing Because He Lives, number 364.
him Jesus.
Thank you for coming this Easter day. I'm blessed by your presence. The benediction is simple. It's basic. It's the benediction that I live by. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they put a candle under a basket. They put it on a lampstand where it gives light to all that are in the house." So let your light shine before men and women and children, that they will see your good works, hear your good words. Then God the Father will be glorified. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace and encourage. Happy Easter.